Hey guys, back today with a review of the QWERTY Tech iMate S. This iMate S is a new printer in the QWERTY Tech line. I'll be sure to go over the specs while you watch me unbox and set it all up. This printer is a pretty large enclosed printer, with it being a decent amount bigger than those FlashForge Creator Max machines I reviewed. The iMate has a build volume of 270mm by 200mm by 200mm. While that's smaller than many other machines out there, since it's entirely enclosed, it does take up a bit more of a footprint than if it weren't enclosed. The printer advertises it has quiet drivers for silent printing, a flexible metal build plate, and an overall well-built frame. The printer also comes with a lot of extras, including a secondary build plate, plenty of spare parts, and even an entirely separate extruder with a 0.2mm diameter nozzle. I find it a little odd to include an entirely separate extruder just to print with a 0.2mm diameter nozzle, because you can just swap the nozzle itself and have the exact same effect. My thoughts are that this is meant for more of an educational setting, because it's trying to be more plug and play and avoid for the need of hot nozzle swapping. That said, this has to add a cost for an entirely separate extruder. This entire printer comes in at a price of $499, so we'll have to see if it's worth it. First things first, I get to printing their included test file. This printer can also have the sides and top removed for when you're printing PLA, since you don't want to heat a chamber when printing in that material. This first test came out great, but it kind of shocked me just how well the material stuck to the build plate. I tested the Z height and leveled the build plate before printing, but it seems that my standard Z height was too close for this build plate. I mean, I really worked on getting the PLA off, and in some areas it was actually impossible to remove. This can be annoying, but it's also great for when working with higher warping materials in this enclosed printer. That said, it's time to slice my first print. It seems that QWERTY has their own slicer, but it also seems to be entirely based on Cura. All of my settings are the same as Cura, it's just the setup and formatting that's a bit different. And to be honest, I kinda like the flow of this slicer setup. It may be a bit more intuitive to someone new to 3D printing. I'm sure it would be easy to get Cura to work with this printer because of this, but I just stick to using QWERTY Print for this review video. I bring in a standard Benchy, tweak the settings a bit, and then get the print you see on the screen now. Once again, it was hard to remove everything from the build plate, so that's just something I'll have to remember for future prints. Overall, this came out pretty clean, ignoring a couple of minor blobs I had, requiring a bit higher retraction settings. Before testing out another material though, I do a bearded gel at high quality, since I like printing this when testing new machines. All relevant links will be in the description down below. I print this at 0.1mm layer heights, and I think it came out pretty dang clean. There is some scarring from some ports, but where it's not scarred, it looks pretty good. All that said, lots of printers can print PLA at high quality. Not all printers can print high warping materials properly. This enclosed printer should allow for this. Unfortunately, my fears were confirmed when I disassembled the hot end to show that it's not all metal, with a Teflon tube running all the way into the nozzle. This means you're going to be limited to right around 240 or 250 degrees Celsius for what your hot end can achieve. Lots of printers don't come with an all metal hot end, including the vast majority of the ones I reviewed on this channel. But I would think that a machine whose strength is its ability to have a heated chamber would have one. Because when I set the build plate to 110 degrees Celsius and wait for a little bit, this chamber gets pretty dang warm, which is a major positive for when you want to print higher temp materials. An exception to this would be ABS, since it normally prints right around 230 degrees Celsius, yet has a high glass transition temperature of over 90 degrees Celsius. It also has a high probability of warping and can benefit from a chamber such as this. I normally don't even really use ABS anymore due to it being difficult to print without warping and there now being so many alternative inexpensive options, but let's give this a try on this machine. I go ahead and use some Polymaker ABS, which actually runs a bit hotter than most ABS at around 250 degrees Celsius. This is a bit higher than I prefer a non-metal hot end to be, but I go ahead and run the printer at this temperature. After putting the sides and top back onto the enclosure, I let the build plate heat all the way to 100 degrees Celsius. It's smart to let your heater stay heated for a little while before starting your print so that the ambient air can get nice and warm. As covered in my material science video, we want to prolong the time the material stays above its glass transition temperature in order to slow the stress release and prevent warping. My first print is just an enlarged strength test that I used to use for testing materials, printed at 100% infill, just because this would normally be extremely difficult to print without warping on an open machine. I also reduced my printing speeds a bit to 45mm per second, because you always have a bit better chance of reducing your warping issues if you print a bit slower. Even slower than 45mm per second will help even more. And this strength bar test at 100% infill came out great. No warping at all, even though I had a bit of an uneven build plate to start with, and no delamination to speak of. In order to show off why this is a major positive, I then go ahead and print the same STL on my open core section with the Hemera extruder. As I've gone over in past videos, this is my main workhorse printer, but since it's not enclosed, it doesn't do great with high warping materials. And this result with the same material on that printer using pretty much the same slicer settings is on the screen now. Not only did the corners and sides warp up, this warping caused the layers to smash together. This smashing caused the ugliness that you see on the screen now. That print along with the one on the iMate S are on the screen now, and there's no question how much nicer the ABS print came out on the iMate S. To finally show off the capabilities of printing ABS in an enclosed printer like this, I find a really large print, this one being the main body to a vise, which I'll link to down below, since the larger the print, the more likely we'll experience warping and delamination. As you could see, no issues whatsoever. I did have some infill lines showing through though, so I need to reduce my infill overlap percentage or increase my shell wall, but there was no warping or delamination on this print. This is actually a big deal because I have a lot of issues printing ABS this size on almost anything in the past. Something this wide and angled would normally be warped on corners, and something this tall would normally experience some delamination if printed on any of my standard printers. So, if you need to print ABS, even larger ABS parts, this machine can get it done. While these results are pretty cool being able to print in ABS, just a minor upgrade of making this hot end to be all metal would allow me to try out PC and so many other high heat materials that need to be in an enclosed chamber to work. I'm assuming they could have cost saved by not giving you an extra extruder and making the first one they send you all metal. Since Quiddy did send that entirely separate extruder with a 0.2mm diameter nozzle, I figured it's only smart if I give that a test as well. As I mentioned earlier, if they just included a 0.2mm nozzle and not this entire setup, it might have taken a little bit more education on how to swap, but this whole setup isn't needed. My assumption is that Quiddy is trying to make this printer as easy to use for students and people new to 3D printing as possible. And having to heat your hot end up to 240 degrees Celsius and wear some heat resistance gloves isn't conducive to that environment. Well, I get to swapping and testing it all out regardless. I slice a bearded yell at half size, and I also print it at 0.05mm layer heights, so that it's half of the bearded yell I printed earlier. It ends up I needed to tweak the support XY distance a bit because it was really hard to get all of this off and without leaving some scarring. That said, it came out really clean where it wasn't scarred, and printed details you wouldn't have been able to see with the 0.4mm line width. This smaller diameter nozzle should allow for the ability to print miniatures, though I have to give a big warning that clogging can really be an issue. I didn't experience it on this test print, but I also ran everything very slow. I actually recommend SLA printing if you do need miniatures, just because it starts to get really difficult and time consuming at very small nozzle diameters, and you'll likely actually be happier with the SLA quality anyway. Alright, time for the pros and cons in this machine, starting with the pros. It's very well built and thought out in many areas. It's very plug and play, no tweaking or modification was needed on my end to get it printing cleanly. The quality of the prints I did were really nice and required pretty much no changes. It's enclosed, meaning you should be able to get a lot of higher ambient air for higher warping prints. And the enclosure design is well made. Even though it says it's printing at 60mm per second, it actually seems a bit faster. It comes with an extra build plate and extra extruder with a 0.2mm diameter nozzle. The print area is lit up with some LED strips, and the touchscreen is very user friendly. And now for the cons. They say it has silent drivers, but this can still be fairly noisy. It's not quite as quiet as my other silent driver printers. It has a couple of odd design quirks. For instance, the touchscreen allows you to cold extrude when it shouldn't. When the stepper motor is disengaged on the Z-axis, it can't hold its weight and it just falls to the bottom. Speaking of that Z-axis, there's only one lead screw when two are normally preferred with this gantry style setup. That said, the build plate is surprisingly firm on there. Most importantly, it doesn't have an all-metal hot end. This means we're limited to printing under 250 degrees Celsius, which, in my opinion, kinda defeats the purpose of having such an enclosed machine. While it may be easier to swap, I'm not quite sure why the second extruder is included. I don't mind having an extra extruder, but you don't need this entire setup just for a nozzle. The extruder seems to be really similar to the ones that were used on the MakerBot Rep 2 like 7 years ago. I'm not sure why people still use extruders like this and they haven't been upgraded. That said, they do seem to work pretty well for high quality prints, but they don't offer any advantages of the extruder upgrades that have been made over the past 5 years. And now for my final thoughts. If this printer had an all-metal hot end, it could easily get a seal of approval from anyone wanting to print higher temp materials. But as is, it's currently just meant to print PLA, ABS, and maybe some TPU. Since both TPU and PLA don't need to be in an enclosed printer, you're really going out of your way to just print an ABS, something that I rarely use anymore. So, is this printer right for you? Well, if you plan on printing ABS, then this is definitely something to consider. I was able to get some really large prints with minimal warping, which is actually quite hard to do on most machines, so I don't want to overlook that. So for ABS, this does fit the bill. And I'm not quite sure how easy it would be to upgrade to an all-metal hot end, so keep that in mind. I'm sure it's possible, anything is on these machines, it just might require some brainstorming for a proper mount. I actually do not currently have a machine that can really keep ambient temps high, so it may be worth looking into for me to upgrade this hot end at some point in the future. $499 for the machine, and then around $50 for an all-metal hot end might end up being a good deal for printing higher temp materials. As is, I think this printer is best used for educational settings. It's one of the more plug-and-play printers that I've personally used, and things like an extruder swap are made easier and safer than swapping a hot nozzle. The slicer is very user-friendly, and I think overall someone brand new to 3D printing would understand how to use this and get clean prints. But for a maker like myself who likes to tinker and use all types of materials, it might not be for me, at least as is without a hot end upgrade. Thank you all for watching. I'll be back soon with further reviews, tutorials, and fun prints.